Welcome to the Real News Network. I'm Greg Wilpert in Baltimore. This is part two of my conversation with Philippine sociologist Walden Bello, who just published a book called Counter-Revolution, The Global Rise of the Far Right. Thanks again, Walden, for having joined us today.
Thanks again for inviting me, Greg.
So in the previous segment, we talked a little bit about the causes of the rise of the far right. And there's a comment I wanted to make, or an observation that I wanted to make about your analysis, actually, that I didn't have a chance to make in the previous segment, which is that it seems to me, and this is kind of a strange phenomenon, that is the right seems to rise under both conditions of neoliberalism and social democracy. That is, on the one hand, it rises when there's social democracy because the elites are afraid and want to roll back those gains. So that's definitely a counter-revolution. But it also seems to rise when there's neoliberalism. And there's, of course, many examples of that, particularly in Europe and the United States. But we see that in other countries where there's been a predominance of neoliberalism, where the right rises. And so it seems a little bit of a damned if you do, damned if you don't kind of situation. That is, whether you introduce, you know, a social market, as they call it in Germany, or that is, you know, a social democracy, or whether you introduce neoliberalism with a very harsh capitalism. In both cases, it seems to bring about the rise of the right, of the far right. At least that seems to have been the tendency in many cases historically and in contemporary society. I want to look at, though, these are two somewhat different circumstances, although they seem to combine sometimes, especially when you think about neoliberalism. And some people actually have called neoliberalism to be a form of counter-revolution. That is, it already is a reaction against the gains of social democracy and the welfare state. Now, I just want to see what your reaction is to that idea that neoliberalism itself is a form of counter-revolution.
Well, yes, I would say that definitely neoliberalism was a big effort on the part of the elites to roll back, you know, the gains of the working class, the capital-labor compromise, the welfare state. So basically, in that sense, it is already a counter-revolution. But what I'm talking about here in the book is something that's because of neoliberalism, you have the crisis in living standards that under circumstances where you would have a progressive party that has a very good analysis and that is anti-neoliberal, that could provide the locus of resistance to neoliberalism. But as I say in the book, in both Europe and the United States, the social democratic parties and the Democratic Party in the United States, you know, basically were won over to neoliberalism, whether we talk about Blair or we talk about the Democratic Party with Bill Clinton. Because of this, you know, there was a sense, you know, that among working classes that they had been abandoned by their traditional parties that they had been, that they had been reliant on in the past to defend welfare state, to defend, you know, the gains that they had made. And the right wing, and, you know, many of them, again, you know, these are usually middle class activists, you know, with, you know, very far right kind of politics, saw an opening here. That is why throughout Europe at this point, you have a stampede of many working class base to these parties at this point in time. I'm not sure some people say that the stampede or the bleeding of the social democratic parties has stopped, but I'm not so sure of that at this point in time. So I guess my point here is, you know, this, you know, counter-revolution because, or a move to the right, you know, or a move to this kind of, you know, very opportunistic kind of programs that basically says, you know, the welfare state will be here but only for those of the right color and the right ethnic stock. So what the right has been able to do is to merge this sort of, you know, social concerns with a racist and ethnic and anti-immigrant kind of program. And that is, you know, a very dynamic and very threatening kind of thing at this point. That is what I would say a very active, heated counter-revolution that is taking place. And in the same sort of dynamics, of course, there are differences in a number of things, including how liberal democracy and neoliberalism failed, but you also see that in countries like India and the Philippines. So you have this middle class led and based movements that quite unexpectedly to many have, you know, captured mass allegiances at this point in time, despite the fact that, for instance, a guy like Duterte almost spits at every value of liberal democracy, and he has an 81% approval rating. Mm-hmm. Now, the only other thing, Greg, that I would like to say here is that we need to distinguish between the active supporters and passive supporters. In a place like the Philippines or in India and others, the active supporters tend to come from the middle classes, but the passive supporters of this counter-revolutionary movements, are usually from the workers, the masses, you know, that's that sort of thing. Like they are brought along with the wave, but they're not necessarily the people who make the ideological justifications for them and create the mass movements and the parties that push these programs.
Right. I think that's, you know, we're basically getting into the area now of the strategies
sure.
that they use to maintain power, which I think is also very important to look at. One of the things that I think is also interesting about this is that these governments oftentimes espouse to be, like you're saying, I think the term that you use in the book is a race-based solidarity
sure.
that seek to protect, as you say, the kind of the welfare state for the in-group,
yeah.
you know, that race, that ethnicity that's predominant or the majority mm-hmm. in that country. But it seems to me also actually, and this is also an interesting point which you raise or one could look at in several different countries, is that they do combine it still with neoliberalism. That is, they're actually dismantling the welfare state. You can see this is particularly the case in the United States of Donald Trump,
sure.
where Obamacare is being dismantled and taxation for the upper class is being dismantled and things like that. So actually, even though he's on the one hand, it's basically rhetoric, this protection for the in-group, because the fact of the matter is that he's actually implementing a lot of neoliberal policies, and you could say that also, I think, to a large extent for the Indian case for Narendra Modi, and maybe even in Turkey and with Erdogan. They're on the one hand, they're, you know, this have this dual nature, and I think you kind of also describe it as being kind of a opportunistic type of government. Just wondering if you could comment on that briefly.
Sure. Well, the relationship of this counter-revolutionary movements with neoliberalism is very interesting in both the North and the Global South. Because whether it's with Marine Le Pen or with the Nordic right-wing parties, they used to be tied up with the right, with anti-tax movements, greater market, quote-unquote freedom, neoliberal programs. But I think over the last 15 years, and you can see this, for instance, in Marine Le Pen's program, they move away from that classical neoliberal program and basically have embraced this program of, you know, we'll keep the welfare state and, you know, but just for the in-group, just for those who have been here since time immemorial, that kind of thing. And you know, it's the enemies are the liberals and the social democrats, who are the people who are trying to bring in, you know, the immigrants. So they are basically, they are reconfiguring social conflicts in a way, you know, that's quite counter-revolutionary. You know, I mean, this is not the kind of elite kind of led coalition. You give me this, you give me that politics. Yeah, this are sort of very interesting class alliances being created with a racist and at the same time pseudo-social democratic kind of ideology. And so that's in the North, with all its contradictions. And I see what you pointed out about Trump. On the one hand, you know, dismantling Obamacare. On the other hand, opportunistically telling the workers, okay, hey, you know, I'm against the Trans-Pacific Partnership. And, you know, that's what you are against, right? So, you know, that's the first, I guess it's the first or second executive order that he made. And so it's a kind of very opportunistic kind of thing. Trump is not a doctrinal neoliberal. He is a very opportunistic kind of right-wing politician who is going to bring together, you know, something that may not have much ideological coherence, but has a lot of emotional coherence that responds to this base that feels threatened, for instance, by immigrants. In the global South, well, there you have a situation where Duterte continues to have a neoliberal program. And Modi, again, he also has a neoliberal program. Both are allied to their elites at this point in time. Despite the fact that the neoliberal program is not working or is not bringing about, you know, the kind of better living conditions, you know, that they had promised, nevertheless, they continue to have a lot of support. So it's a very interesting and at the same time very dangerous, you know, kind of situation. A combination of neoliberalism and great popularity.
Right. Before we conclude, have to touch also on the issue of the strategies that can be used to overcome counter-revolutionary regimes. Now, in a nutshell, what would you say would be the best way to confront them?
Well, I think the first thing is, I think it's going to be very, very important to really hold on and espouse and promote democratic values and the values of protection for human beings, human rights, due process, which is being threatened everywhere. For instance, Duterte basically has said due process does not hold for criminals, and he's ended up killing over 20,000 people. And basically, it's not a popular thing at this point in time, but we really have to uphold this traditional democratic values, the right to life, the right and human rights. Secondly, I think we cannot just go back and promote and say to people, hey, we've got to go, you know, we have to go back to democracy. And people will tell you, what do you mean democracy, for instance, in the early Philippines at this point in time. This so-called democracy that you kept on telling us, we have been under it for decades, things are still extremely bad for the masses of people. Inequality is great and everything else. Your democracy hasn't delivered. So I think what we really need to do is to go beyond these elite liberal democracies and really propose as, social democratic programs. I mean, I use that in a scientific sense, not in a political sense. But we really have to put equality at the center now. We cannot just have this formal equality, but real inequality. I think both in the United States, in Europe, in the global South, equality has now to be at the center. Now, whether we call this program socialist or social democratic or, you know, popular democracy, for me, that's not important. But the important thing is we have to distinguish that from the kind of capitalist liberal democracy that, you know, that has hidden class conflict and has not really delivered. And then the third thing is we really have to find a way to counter the mass appeal of these demagogues that are appearing at this point in time. So one of the problems with progressive movements are oftentimes they're so rationalistic, if you know what I mean. and so basically the appeal is very much based on the interests. The appeal is very much sometimes very economistic in terms of its appeal to different groups. And they haven't been able to win people emotionally. Now, I think we can win people emotionally in a good way and not in a fascist way. But we really have to try and try very hard on that score. And then the other thing that I think we really need to look at is really the importance of the women's movement at this point in time. Because all of these people, whether it's Trump, whether it's Duterte, they are misogynists. They are espousing misogynism in their behavior and the way they in their programs. And the women's movement throughout the world is on the rise, and is quite uncompromising at this point in time. And I think it has a very great role to play in terms of opposing these moves towards counter-revolution and fascism, which are very misogynistic right now. So these are just some things that I've been thinking about in terms of the way that we can get a handle on these movements and then confront them. But the important thing, one important thing I would just like to say, Greg, is we have to give up. We can't fall into conspiracy theories, that these are just people being manipulated by elites or by clever people. There is a mass base, to this right-wing movements, and I think we really need to accept that and then see how we can go toe-to-toe with them in terms of winning over the allegiances of people.
Yeah, I think that's your point there is very well taken, very important, and especially also for the left, I think it's crucial to understand the rise of the right in order to figure out, well, where did we go wrong, so to speak? I mean, like I said, it seems like they're both the rise of the right is linked to both neoliberalism and social democracy.
Sure.
In other
sure.
words, if we want to avoid the rise of the right in the future, that means having to overcome both neoliberalism and social democracy. But unfortunately, we're going to have to leave it there for now.
Sure.
I was speaking to Philippine sociologist Walden Bello about his just published book, Counter-Revolution, The Global Rise of the Far Right. Thanks again, Walden, for having joined us today.
Thanks too, Greg. I'm very happy to have been in your program today.
And thank you for joining the Real News Network.
Hey, y'all. My name is Tharna Noor, and I'm a climate crisis reporter here at The Real News Network. This is a crucial moment for humanity and for the planet. So if you like what we do, please, please support us by subscribing at the link below. Thank you.